Well, welcome back. Let's get started with effective Java with Groovy, and by learning how effective Java is applicable in Groovy, you will end up learning how language can influence adoption of good practices rather than just creating a to-do list of what's good, what's not good. Hi, my name is Naresha. And you already know me. So let's get started with this, right? Java started as a platform independent technology where you write once and run anywhere. That was the claim. And a very interesting piece of this entire Java ecosystem was the JVM. Because of that, multiple languages could be hosted on JVM. And Groovy was, in fact, one of the first language which was hosted on JVM. I mean, of course, apart from Java, though there were other languages which were ported onto JVM before. Interesting fact to be noted is that as of today, JVM is the strongest part of Java ecosystem, which has been even acknowledged by people like James Gosling, who has been attributed as a father of Java. And when it comes to effective Java, I believe it is one of the popular books which helped many of us when we started with Java, what is the right way to program using a Java platform. Let's come to Groovy. Right. So what was the motivation behind starting Groovy? So Groovy was started totally out of pragmatism, not to just to say experiment with the particular methodology or a particular belief, rather, how to make developers more productive at their day-to-day tasks. That has been the objective of Groovy. And whatever mechanism, those days, of course, it was a dynamic language that just, incidentally happened to be the best available mechanism those days to implement a productive language. With that, what we will do here is explore a few items from effective Java book and see how they are applicable to Groovy applications. So when we go through this, these are the items that will help you to understand where you are. So we will start with the context or the problem. Whenever we have a problem, what do? We consult the expert, right? In this case, the expert is effective Java. Then we try to implement the solutions in Groovy and explore a few potential traps that you may want to avoid, right? These mostly are like copying implementations, rather copying Java implementation into Groovy. And then we move towards what are the Groovier solution, what is the right way to do it in Groovy, and by doing this, what did we learn? For this, we also see like what tool that has helped us to come up with a better solution, one. And also what are the principles and wisdom behind these approaches. With that, let's get started right away. What you're seeing is Java code. The symbol on the top right should help you to identify whether it's a Java language or a Groovy language. So it's a simple program where, essentially say you are buying 10 items of say 10 cents, and finally you calculate what is the total. Well, you get this value. Now, suppose you are a customer, would you be happy to pay this? Definitely not, right? So let's go ahead and change our code to use double instead of float. And now you end up with this, which you know, the owner of the shop will not be happy to see, right? If you refer effective Java, the relevant point here is avoid float and double if exact answers are required, right? This is what many Java developers end up making mistake, especially if they're working with the financial application. It's quite dangerous to fall into this trap. So let's say, what do we do? We know we have to use big decimal, right? So let's use a big decimal. In this case, can we say that the problem is solved? Oh, not really, right? Because when we created the big decimal from double, we have already lost the precision over there. So instead, you have to, you know, use the string constructor out of the constructor, which accepts a string. Maybe that's you know, one option what you have. So now you get you know, one. But in Groovy, if you try it right away using type inference, so I'm using you know, not using the specific types, float or double, anything like that, and out of the box I get the right answer without any surprises. So if I want to know what exactly happens under the hood, Groovy used a big decimal type, you know, without you being explicit about that. So the in type inference, what Groovy did is most optimal. So what did we learn here? A language for a particular context. Of course, you know, this is not, this cannot be universal always. But yeah, selecting the appropriate type for the context is very, very important. Predominantly, you would use Groovy for you know, writing business applications. So in that context, this is the right type. And try to have you know, the principle of least astonishment, so that you know, whatever is expected, developers get that without having to, you know, learn a lot about it. That was the first item what we saw. Let's move on to the next one. In this case, we start with the class called product, which has three attributes: SKU, description, and price. Now let's create two instances of the product using the same set of values. All the three attributes are same, and I check the equality. Oh, that's a surprise, right? Ideally, the intention of the developer here would be that these two are, you know, true rather than false. Just to be clear, you know, the equality is actually similar to calling equals in Groovy. On a similar line, we create a map, hash map called stock, and I use the book object as the key to insert a value into the map. And finally, I use the key, which is the second object, book2, and try to retrieve the value. And similarly, we get null here. So if you explore why this has happened, it's all to do with these two methods, equals and hashCode, defined in the root object, the topmost you know, object in the hierarchy in Java, that is object. And by default, two objects are equal if they are you know, actually pointing to the same instance, not otherwise. And hashCode is unique per instance. That's the reason why we were getting that behavior. Now, essentially, we know that we have to override equals and hashCode in our product class. And we have to remember you know, these suggestions, right? Obey the general contract when overriding equals, the consistency between equals and hashCode, and always override hashCode when you know, you override equals. Especially if you know, two objects are equal, you have to have they have to have the same hashCode. And the book goes on detail how to implement these for several pages. Now you have two options to implement you know, equals and hashCode without say completely hand coding them. One option is to make use of a library like this Apache Commons language provides these equals builder and hashCode builder. That is one of the options you have. Another option you have is to, you know, use your IDE and say generate equals and hash code. But typically I see two problems with these approaches, right? So in this case, you would see that I have to, you know, specifically pass the list of fields to be used. Here in this case, there is a, you know, append field one, append field two, append field three, you're using that. So which you have to do it twice, once for equals builder, once for hash code builder, effectively violating the DRY principle. So the representation of these fields, you know, you can end up with the inconsistent implementations. That's why, you know, the idea of having two builders isn't great. And with the IDE, if you generate the code, what happens is, you know, over a period of time, if your class changes, say you have three attributes, you add one more date of manufacture later on, add one more date of expiry, something like this, do you really remember to go and update equals and hash code methods, which was prior, you know, earlier generated maybe by the IDE? So typically we say that, you know, change is the only thing that is constant. So these two approaches may work for one time well, but considering that your code has to change frequently, those approaches aren't optimal, or they actually, you know, are based on wrong assumptions. So what Groovy provides is the AST transformation, not two transformations, single transformation here at equals and hash code by default, which takes all the fields and generate for into consideration for generating equals and hash code. So now what happens is, you know, we get as expected, it's true. And, you know, from the stock, if you want to retrieve, you are going to get the value as expected. Well, did we solve everything? No. Previous case, we used the class was more like you know, value object or you know, data transfer object. In this case, say you are considering say, you know, an entity like something which you want to persist, right? Say in this case, you are using ID as the auto-generated value, and you might think, okay, let me put ID as generate a hash code and equals based on ID. But then, you know, that's not a right approach to use, because, you know, initially you may not have an ID, and later on ID will get generated when you persist the object. So now again, there is a, you know, inconsistency in the object that is in memory and what was persisted, that could happen. So typically it's a good idea to use, you know, the business key. In this case, it happens to be the stock keeping unit, and use that for, you know, generating your equals and the hash code. What did we learn here? Use the AST transformation, which, you know, Groovy makes use of. So the required code gets generated at compile time by the compiler rather than the IDE. And every time you make a change, obviously you have to go and compile your code, and, you know, the corresponding implementation will get updated automatically. The benefit you get, and you know, sticking to DRY principle, any knowledge has to be, you know, represented in one place rather than you know, duplicating them in multiple places. What do you think of this image? Complexity, right? Let's look at some you know, imperative code and see what say the traditional for loop versus you know, for each loop, this is the recommendation in the effective Java, which says prefer for each loops to traditional for loops. And let's say literally, let's translate that into Groovy. So Groovy for each loop looks like this, using you know, for in, and let's say we create some, but that's not how we should interpret it. So of course, you have the each higher order method, we could use that, but not just that, right? Suppose say we want to perform a map operation, so we can use numbers.collect and each number multiplied by two, that's what we want. Or say I want to calculate the sum here, I could use the fold left, which is a inject method, you know, so that we have a declarative code rather than a verbose code with the fewer moving parts rather than having many moving parts, and you end up making mistakes. What did we learn? Again, we used closures or higher order functions. That's what was handy. And the right way to interpret, use for each loop instead of traditional for loop here is, favor internal iterators to external iterators. And obviously minimizing the moving parts will make your code better and reduce the possibility of bugs. Next, let's think about this, right? Think for a moment, what is the $1 billion effort typically in Java code? It has to be obviously the null check, right? You would see left and right, every part of code is doing null check, which may not be very productive. So let's take a code, something like this. I have a get speakers method, which takes a conference name and returns list of speakers, right? Which I could use something like this. I say get speakers of Apache Con at home 2020. And I'm not doing anything. I'm returning null here. So obviously if it returns null, every time I invoke this method, I'll have to perform a null check, which can be really, really painful. Suppose say you have a colleague who does this and you have to use this method in your Groovy code. Ideally, you would, the recommendation is you would use, don't return nulls wherever you expect a collection, rather use, empty array, empty collection, right? Empty list or empty map, anything of that sort. Now let's call the same Java method in Groovy, right? So this returns null, we know already that. We say dot collect, and we want to collect the first names of the speakers. And the second case, I want to filter and I want only those speakers whose first name has more than 5 characters. So typically, I didn't do a null check here. You would end up with the null pointer exception. But in Groovy, you are saved, right? Even if your colleague has intentionally put that code making you work more, oh no, that's not possible that way. You are saved from all the malicious intents. The reason why that happens is because the literal nulls were replaced with the null object. So in null object, it would typically behave like a null, but for iterator, it will return an empty iterator, rather than null. That's how you are saved from all these problems. Null object pattern rather than null literal mostly. So, and with which you reduce a lot of boilerplate code, which means developers can be productive and code is more readable. And life is too short for null checks. Let's consider this. That's the side effect. So whenever you hear the word side effect, what comes to your mind? It's mutability or immutability and immutability, right? Whether you're objects or data should be mutable or immutable. And sometimes, when I look at this, it comes surprising to me that, effective Java specifically talks about minimize immutability. Maybe I think if it was not this, probably I would have believe that Java is all about favoring mutability, not so much of immutability. That's an interesting point I note, especially at this point in time. And the book also talks about why you have to minimize immutability, because it tells how immutability is simple and mutability is not simple. And then it goes on to say how to make a class immutable. It goes on there's a long list. We don't want to go and explore that. Let's say we use something like this. Predominantly, you have to make all the fields private, and you have to use a constructor for initializing each and every field here. Of course, you have to write a lot of boilerplate code. That is the first problem. The second problem is remembering the order of the parameters in the constructor can be a challenging aspect. Instead, what Groovy does is Groovy, provides this AST transformation called immutable. So you use that on your class, automatically all your fields become final, and you also get a constructor, which is the, you get a constructor with the map argument, and you could call your methods like that. So you can follow any order. It looks like a named argument, right? That's the benefit you get. Just to be noted here is that, the use of map constructor or using like a named argument fashion was available even in the absence of, map constructor. In that case, it was done using the setters, but since in immutable, you can't have setters, what happens is when you use at immutable, map constructor gets generated. And should look something like this. That's representation of generated code, in fact. And the tool used again is AST transformation, a little bit of syntactic sugar in place of that map constructor. And readability matters, so much concise code is better rather than you end up writing a lot of code and making more mistakes. Well, let's get into the golden hammer. So when it comes to Java, what do you think is the golden hammer, right? When you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And that is, inheritance. And we have heard this several times, favor composition over inheritance. But then we don't see much of this being, implemented in predominantly in not so in Java code. So let's take this example. I have a list of phone numbers here, and I want to perform a typical operation, like I want to find or call any of the methods available in the collections. That is one. And I want to add some additional methods, something like something ends with the 4 or anything like that. Typically, I mean, this is the typically something which is available. Something I want to add, something like get an Indian number, which want to check for certain patterns. So the first thing comes is, okay, what I want, most of the methods are already available in ArrayList. So the best option would be, or rather you think it's easy to, extend from ArrayList than doing anything else. And we forget favor composition to inheritance part. Instead, what Groovy offers is like it makes composition easier. So I can say I can compose, I can have a field, which is a list, and I can put at delegate AST transformation. So all of the methods from the list will be delegated to list without having to manually redirect them or redirect or delegate them. Any other additional methods, you can always write it here, and it works like that. Of course, Groovy has evolved with other mechanisms for composition. I'll talk about more of that in my next presentation. For now, let's see what, AST transformation is a tool that Groovy used. And it's much better to simplify things for the developers, who happen to be the users of the language, rather than coming up with the big list of what to do, what not to do. That, in my opinion, that makes a significant difference. Let's come to design patterns. And one of the patterns we talk about, let's say singleton, which is mentioned in the Effective Java book. It talks about, enforce the singleton property with the private constructor. Let's start with this, right? We take, I mean, in this case, what I'm trying to do is use the Java implementation of Singleton, copy it into Groovy and try to run. So I call the get instance twice. I'm getting the same instance, which is absolutely good. Now let me say, try to call invoke the constructor, and you would see that you are ending up with a new object, which is not what you would want here. What's wrong here? Things are simple. You copying Java implementation is not always a great idea. Rather, you have a much simpler option, which is the Singleton AST transformation. You could use that. Now let's say, okay, we have two instances, M1 and M2. Are they equal? Yes, they are equal. And if you try to invoke the constructor now, you get an error message, right? You can't instantiate Singleton. And now the question comes is more of what if I don't want to go for eager initialization, the manager instance to be initialized lazily when the first call comes. Now you would see it's often people might end up missing synchronized, right? That could be challenging. Then there is a volatile, otherwise there could be issues of cache not syncing into memory, etc. You don't have to do all those in Groovy. You could, all you have to do is, pass the lazy attribute as true. Singleton, now your Singleton will be implemented with the lazy initialization and with the right amount of, locking so that there are multiple get calls. They are not blocked, one is not blocked for another. Whereas, for a instance creation, you need to have the part of that code executed in a synchronized block. Now, what we learned again, AST transformation and Yagni principle. You may not need that lazy by default. So if you need, you put that. So again, assuming the default right set of values for the default is also very very important aspect, which has been done in a good way here. So let's see what are the takeaways. Some of the, we can't blame Java for not doing this right. Sometimes a lot of these were discovered after the language, came into existence, while Groovy had, didn't not work in Java, what is not very productive in Java. These were very much available to Groovy when that was designed. But it's important that those learnings were taken and baked into the language right away, making developers productive. And there are AST transformation available, which makes relatively easy to implement newer features. And copying Java implementation may not be always a good thing. There are better Groovy implementations. And one of the important aspect I look at here is how programming languages can reduce the friction to implement good practices. So when as a developer, you are when it's easy and you are more productive, you just enjoy your work. So that way, programming languages play a crucial role in encouraging developers to use good practices, not just having a checklist. And the most important aspect I would see, especially with the Groovy here, is that in plenty of our examples, what made the code better or what was the tool behind the Groovy feature was AST transformation. And AST transformation is available for all the Groovy users, so you can write your own AST transformation. You really don't have to wait for the language to change maybe in the next versions. You can take small steps and fill the gap. So that tool, what makes Groovy developers create the language, is what is available to Groovy users. That's one of the finest thing, which is very unique to Groovy language, I say. Not all languages do that. So whatever, you know, most of the items I talked about, I have written few posts and the link is available here. And with that, I'm open for questions. Are there any questions already?
This seems to be one from Dan.
Okay, is there a name for the pattern? Give me a clone of current immutable with the field X changed to Y. I don't think that. Copy with. Paul is saying.
Other questions? Hey, Paul.
Yeah, I have seen it with pattern, but it's not one of the ones that you'll find in the Martin Fowler's refactorings book or anything under that name, I don't think.
Well, if that's all the questions that were there, I would like to say thank you to Narisha.
Thanks, everyone. Hope that was useful.
And in about 10 minutes, less than 10 minutes, Guillaume Laforge will do his talk called What Would a New Groovy Web Console Look Like? And